Let It Go by Dame Stephanie Shirley with Richard Askwith. Read by Rachel Atkins. Let It Go. Forward. You can't be what you can't see is a line I often deploy when talking to people about the complex issues of equality in the rapidly growing technology sector. How can girls choose careers in technology if they don't see opportunities for them in companies? How can women apply for jobs in the sector or start technology-based businesses if the world looks so unlike them? Well, if we looked in the right direction, we would see Dame Stephanie Shirley, the woman we should all aspire to be. I am lucky enough to call Dame Stephanie Shirley my friend. We first met while giving speeches at the same conference over a decade ago, and with characteristic kindness, she invited me to lunch at her favourite London base, the Royal Society of Medicine. Lunch with Steve, as she calls herself, is a delight. She has a wit, strength, and intelligence that are rare. I am certain that she will be infuriated I even mention it, but her energy is remarkable and would be for a woman even half her age. Our conversations are always wider-ranging and direct, but they often come back to one subject, comparing our experiences as entrepreneurs. I co-founded lastminute.com at a time when people were sceptical in Europe that the internet was even going to survive, let alone thrive. We had to convince investors, suppliers, and of course customers that putting credit card details into a website was safe and might actually be convenient. However, compared to the challenges Steve faced 30 years earlier, they pale into insignificance. It is unbelievable to think that at a time when women were not even recognised as equal in the workplace under law, Steve employed only women, all working from home and all working on complex public sector projects such as the black box for Concorde. No fluffy, lightweight contracts. Hers were with government departments, often dealing with issues of national security. We seem to have gone backwards, or at least sideways, in using Steve's creative ways to build successful, diverse companies. Steve trailblazed her way all those decades ago, and I believe we urgently need to look to her example if we want to create the most resilient, robust, and effective companies for the future. But it is not only her extraordinary success as a technology entrepreneur that marks out Steve. She is a role model for how to build your life, not just your company. Steve's philanthropic work is as remarkable as her commercial work. She has shown me how you can break down silos between the public and private, and how building an organisation with social aims is as entrepreneurial as building one for profit. Steve's beloved late son, Giles, had a form of autism that required full-time care. Faced with this mammoth personal challenge, Steve didn't just provide for that care, she reimagined how children like him should be looked after and built Prior's Court, a school and home for autistic children. I have visited the school and it is beautiful. Set in the rolling English countryside, what struck me immediately was the art all over the grounds. Steve was so perceptive in understanding that often it is this art to which the children can most easily and quickly relate. All the facilities for the children are world-leading, but when I visited with her, Steve was still restless and keen to keep adding to them. The latest idea was to build a bakery so the community could bake bread and sell it, and a year after our visit, the bakery opened. What I take from her story is not just how to be a woman in a male-dominated industry, but more importantly, how to have a life that is meaningful for its entire length. Too often, especially in the culture of startups and technology, we lionise founders who build huge monopolies or who achieve some massive company valuation. Steve did this, but she did far more of more importance as well. I hope that in reading this remarkable memoir, you will take some inspiration, as I do, from this brave and brilliant woman. We can see what we should all be. Let's just make sure we are all looking. Baroness Martha Lane Fox. Chapter 1. A Strange Journey. My earliest memory of England is of Liverpool Street Station. It was a grey day in July, a few weeks before the outbreak of the Second World War. I'm not sure if it was raining as I stumbled from train to platform, or indeed what time of day it was. All I remember is the shadows, and the great cast-iron pillars and walkways, and the pain in my foot. I was 5 years old. My nine-year-old sister and I had been travelling for more than 2 days, on a grim, tearful journey from Vienna. We knew scarcely half a dozen words of English between us, and I, at least, had only the vaguest idea of where we were going and why. There were about 1,000 of us on the train, all Jewish, all children, apart from two young women charged with looking after us all, and nearly all distraught. We had numbered tickets hanging round our necks as if we were lost property. In a sense, we were. 2.5 days earlier, we had all said goodbye to our parents, in my case, just my mother, for what was, for most of us, the last time. We were among the last, and I was almost the youngest, of around 10,000 child refugees who were saved from Hitler's terror by that great gamble of hope and despair that came to be known as the Kindertransport. For much of the previous year, millions of Jews in Germany and Austria, and later Czechoslovakia and Poland, had been struggling to come to terms with the once unthinkable truth that the civilized nations in which their lives were rooted had descended into deadly barbarism. Many resigned themselves to staying put and hoping for the best, but others calculated, correctly, that staying put was equivalent to signing their families' death warrants. Yet the rest of the world had largely closed its borders to refugees. So when a coalition of concerned groups in the UK formed the Movement for the Care of Children from Germany, later known as the Refugee Children's Movement, and gained official permission for up to 10,000 Jewish children to be admitted as refugees, some families, including mine, decided that they had no choice but to send their children away to Britain to be fostered. It is almost impossible, from the comfort and safety of today, to imagine the mental agonies that such parents must have endured. Extraordinary leaps of faith and imagination would have been required. Faith in the kindness of unseen strangers, but also imagination of what Nazism must ultimately lead to. Unbearable pangs of doubt and regret must have followed. For us children, it was simpler. Our lives, as we had known them, were coming to an end when they had scarcely begun. Not all of us realised the full awfulness of what was happening as our families voluntarily dissolved themselves. I suspect that most of the parents had scarcely faced up to the full truth themselves, let alone spoken unambiguously about it to their children. But the sense of bereavement on the platform in Vienna had been overwhelming. There were enough wailing adults, never mind howling children, to make a mockery of those who were trying to put a brave face on it. Maybe there were a few of us who really believed that we were being sent off on a nice adventure, but it was hard not to see the truth in the grown-ups' eyes. Perhaps I should have been grateful for the pain in my foot. Most of my fellow passengers had nothing to distract them from the pain of being sent away, but I was too miserable to be interested in anyone else. I had grazed a big toe a few days earlier, and the wound had somehow become infected. Now, with each passing hour, the dull, throbbing ache became more tormenting. Perhaps it masked the ache of separation, or perhaps the two aches have merged in my memory. It is hard, after all these years, to be certain how many of the remembered details of the journey are real and how much I have added to my mental picture from other sources. Was the weather outside really grey? Or have I just seen too many black and white photographs of the Kinter transport? Did one boy keep getting out to be sick during the train's many unscheduled pauses? Or was that just a dream? I am pretty certain that children slept on the floor as well as on the long wooden benches that lined the sides of the carriages. There were some large strips of corrugated cardboard that they used as mattresses. I presume that I slept too, although I cannot remember doing so. I think our parents had given us sandwiches for the journey, but again, I may be wrong. But I do know that they had given us presents. In my case, two tiny model dogs joined together on a miniature leash, which we were forbidden to open until the train was moving, making us heartlessly eager for the journey to begin. I know too that I clung grimly for most of the journey to my favourite doll. I remember many stops and occasional frightening interruptions from uniformed guards. I recall vividly the cold, oily smell of the sea, an entirely new experience when we eventually reached the channel, presumably at the Hook of Holland, and I vaguely remember a nauseous crossing in a cabin below deck. I am certain that at some point in the train journey, children slept on the long overhead luggage racks, although the scene in my mind's eye is quite different from the carriage interiors I have seen in archive photographs. And I doubt that there is much wrong with my impression that there was scarcely a moment in those 2.5 days of travelling when our miseries were not exasperated by the jarring sound of other people's crying. But what about my sense that, when we finally arrived at Liverpool Street, the platform was silent? It seems somehow implausible, and perhaps I have merely projected the numbness of my emotions onto the past. Nonetheless, that is how my mind has preserved it. We spilled out onto the platform, speechless and wide-eyed, as if in a dream. Most of us were wearing hats and overcoats. We were allowed to bring only as much luggage as we could carry, and so our parents, desperate that we should not go cold or ragged in the strange new world into which they were banishing us, had packed our little cases to bursting point and then flung a few extra garments on us for good measure. Our coats still bore the yellow stars we'd been forced to have sewn onto them in Austria. The slow river of exhausted, bewildered, tear-stained faces flowed noiselessly down the platform. Renata, my sister, and I found ourselves in a huge, high, cavernous hall, now long since demolished, where, after a quick roll call, we waited for our new families. There were piles of palliasses, big bags filled with straw, heaped up against one of the walls, and the air was sickly with the smell of unwashed children. None of us had any idea what to expect. The RCM had simply advertised in various British newspapers for families who were willing to foster a refugee child or two, and Renata and I knew nothing about the couple who had volunteered to take us in, beyond their names. Every now and then adults would hurry past and say things, and occasionally announcements were made, but the strange language meant nothing to us. Our father had, at the last minute, taught us a handful of English phrases, but they were bizarre and random things such as windscreen wiper and slow combustion stove. I had no idea how to ask to go to the toilet, let alone how to understand strangers' explanations about what was going to happen to us. The afternoon wore on. Renata and I sat on a palliasse at the back and watched as more and more children were led away, usually in ones or twos. No one seemed to protest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.